as we saw, as you saw, I listened to it, but as you saw in chapter 11, the Lord announces to Moses that there is going to be one more plague that he's going to bring against Egypt. This would be the worst plague of all. He was going to literally kill the firstborn of all those people and animals in the land of Egypt. Now, by this time, everybody realized that the God of the Hebrews, Yahweh, was in charge. He is in control. He is the creator of the heavens and the earth. And he was proclaiming his power and his might through these horrific signs and wonders. And so the fear of the Lord is upon all the Egyptians except Pharaoh. And even though nine plagues have devastated all the land of Egypt and all the people of Egypt, Pharaoh's heart was as hard and as callous as anyone's heart has ever been. Nine times God was giving him a way out of these judgments. Nine times he told Pharaoh through Moses, let my people go out into the wilderness to worship me. And these things would stop, but Pharaoh's heart grew harder and harder. In chapter 11, when God told Moses what the final plague was all about and what it would accomplish, he also told Moses to tell the Jews, go to your neighbors, ask them for gold and silver. And as you know, the people were more than willing to give the Jews massive amounts of gold and silver and clothing. And this would serve a twofold purpose. Number one is, it's like retribution for the Jews. They've been harshly treated as slaves. They were bond slaves to the, not bond slaves, they were just slaves to the Egyptians. So that would be like retribution, restitution for them. And then the other thing, the most important thing is, God would use all that gold and silver that the Jews brought out into the wilderness to make and fashion the tabernacle. And that would be the place where God would meet with the Jews for 40 years as they wandered into the wilderness, and then they would bring that tabernacle into the promised land eventually. Now, this would all fulfill a prophecy that God gave to Abraham about 500 years earlier. And it's found in Genesis chapter 15. Look at these verses, starting in verse 13. Then he, God, said to Abram, and so this is even before Abram, you know, has changed his name to Abraham. This is before his only recognized son, Isaac, was born. He said to Abram, know certainly that your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs, and will serve them, and they will afflict them 400 years. And also the nation whom they serve, I will judge. Afterward, they shall come out with great possessions. And so that prophecy about 500 years earlier is about to be fulfilled in this chapter, later on in this chapter 12. Now, once again, as you saw in chapter 11, verse 7, God would make a distinction between the people of Egypt and the Israelites, his chosen people. And as we'll see in chapter 12, the only difference between these two groups of people is this. One group will apply the blood of the lamb to their homes, and the other group will not apply the blood to their homes. And as we'll also see, that is the only difference between those of us who are saved today and those who are not saved. Thus, those of us who are saved, we have applied the blood of Jesus to our lives. His blood has washed us clean. His blood has cleansed us of all unrighteousness. The other group, the unsaved, they mock the blood of Christ. And so, Exodus 12, this is one of the turning point chapters in the entire Bible. This will not only mark the end of their 400 plus years in Egypt, but this will mark the beginning of a whole new relationship with God, with their Lord, that they really haven't known for a long time. Now remember, in the first nine plagues that God sent upon Egypt, God was showing his superiority over all these pagan gods that the Egyptians worshipped. With this tenth plague, there's one more pagan god that the Lord will need to defeat, and that is Pharaoh and his firstborn son. Why? Because they were looked at and worshipped as gods. And so God is going to quickly show Pharaoh, you are not a god. You're not even close to being a god. But the main theme of chapter 12 is how the Lord will establish the feast of Passover with the people of Israel. This would be an annual feast that will commemorate the great deliverance that God would bring to the Israelites as he miraculously sets them free from the bondage in Egypt. And by the way, all the preparation for this feast, all the food that they will use for this feast, it all points to Jesus. He's the fulfillment of Passover. In fact, Jesus would die on the cross at the exact time that Passover was being prepared. As the animals were being sacrificed at 3 p.m., that's when Jesus died on the cross as the final Lamb of God. Our world today is very much like it was in Egypt. The death sentence was hanging over Egypt at this time. The death sentence is hanging over this world at this time. Jesus would accomplish a greater deliverance than what God did here, even with the Israelites. About 2 to 3 million Israelites will be delivered from the bondage of Egypt. But think of the last 2,000 years and the gospel of Christ going forth. Billions of people have been delivered from the worst slavery of all, sin. Sin that leads to death and destruction. And Jesus has delivered us. And there's only one way to be spared from this judgment of God. There's only one way to be forgiven and reconciled to God, and that is through the blood of Jesus Christ. So look at chapter 12. We'll get about halfway through this chapter, Lord willing, this morning. It says in verse 1, "Now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, 'This month shall be your beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you.'" And so the first thing that God does here is he creates a whole new calendar for the nation of Israel. And as many of you know, the Jewish people, they have two calendars. They have a civil calendar. In fact, this year, their civil calendar, like we celebrate New Year's Day, that's the beginning of our civil calendar. For the Jews, September 15th this year is Rosh Hashanah. That's the beginning of their new year, their civil calendar. But God is establishing a spiritual religious calendar, you might say, with Passover. And that always falls in March or April. Interesting. So this is the first day of their new start, their new religious calendar that Passover brings. Now, it's interesting that, you know, you look at our Easter celebration, our Resurrection Sunday, and you know how it's different every year. It's always sometime in March or April. That's because it's based on the lunar calendar. The Jews use the lunar calendar. That's why it varies a little bit every year. And so we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus 3 days after Passover, and that's why it's always a little bit different. Now, this new calendar, this religious calendar, coincides with God giving them a brand new beginning, as it says here. He's giving them a new start in life, a new identity, you might say. They're leaving Egypt. They're no longer going to be slaves. God is going to give them a new address. He's going to do a new work. They're going to be heading to a new land, the land of promise. And as they begin their new life together, God is basically telling them, start looking at your life from this point on, this new calendar I'm giving you, beginning with Passover. You are under a new calendar. And by the way, that's true for all of us as well. When we believed in Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we got a whole new identity in Christ. And we also have two addresses. You know, we have an address here in Colorado, and I jokingly say we have another address, 777 Pearly Gate Way, up in Glory. I asked people first service, I don't think anybody knew. Have you ever heard of Isaac Air Freight? Yeah, I knew Stan would know. He's old too. Isaac Air Freight, they were a comedy group. Back when the Jesus movement, when all the bands were traveling around and all that, there was a comedy group. They were all born-again Christians. They would come to Calvary Chapel, known as Isaac Air Freight. You have to look them up. They got some goofy stuff. You look at it now, it's like, yeah, how did I laugh at that? That was pretty weird. But they always use that 777 Pearly Gate Way because people always say, why do you say that? Stuck in my head. I'm sorry. It's 45 years ago. Anyway, most of us have these two calendars, not just two adders. We have two calendars. We have a calendar when we were born. I was born December 14th, 1956. Man, you're getting old, Jeff. Yeah, I know. So that's when I was born physically into this world. But then an even more important calendar for me is my spiritual birth. That was November 30th, 1977. So I'm younger than I look, I know. But that was the day when Jesus brought me to spiritual life. That was the day all my sins were washed away. Like Ephesians 2 verse 1 says, that was the day that you, he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins. Or 2 Corinthians 5:17 tells us, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And so we've been made alive in Christ. We're born again. We've been forgiven. We've been given a new identity, a new future to look forward to. But one of the key parts of the Christian life is to make the necessary adjustments in your calendar. In other words, start looking forward to the new life you have in Christ. Start living each day for Jesus and not for the old world that you left behind. Let those things go. Yes, we are in this world, but we are not of this world. We look at this world differently because we are different. Jesus lives within us. His Holy Spirit is upon us. And this is why so many Christians struggle, because they never make the adjustment. They continue to live their old lifestyle under the old calendar, and they're stuck in Egypt rather than walking the freedom of new life in Christ in the promised land, the land flowing with milk and honey, the abundant life of walking in the Spirit. Look at verse 3. He says, speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, on the 10th of this month, every man shall take for himself a lamb, according to the house of his father, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of the persons, according to each man's need. You shall make for your count for the lamb. And it became 10 persons for one lamb. Now, back in Jesus' day, when, you know, there were 3 required feasts. Passover was the main feast. The Jews had to go to Jerusalem for Passover. And Jerusalem was normally about 250,000 people. But during Passover, it'd be about 2.5 million people would be there. And so, do the math, one lamb for every 10 people, that was 250,000 lambs that were slaughtered on Passover. Josephus, who was living around the time of Jesus, he was a Jew that was a historian for the Romans, he said at one Passover, and it was just after Jesus had died and so forth, 254,000 lambs were sacrificed in Jerusalem on one Passover. So one for every 10 people, just for your information. Your lamb, he says in verse 5, shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. Now you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight. So again, what we see here is the main focus is on the lamb. From the 10th to the 14th, so 5 days, they would bring this lamb in. They would raise it from a baby lamb, and now it's a year old. It was like a household pet. And so from the 10th to the 14th of Nisan, on the Jewish calendar, the Jews would have to make sure their young lamb was without spot, without blemish. It had to pass inspection. And so they were very careful how they examined these lambs for the 10th through the 14th. They had to make sure no blemishes. What was a blemish? Well, a blemish was something that happened to the lamb, like it got injured. Maybe it broke a leg, or, you know, it got, you know, chewed up by a wolf, or, you know, an eye came out or something. You couldn't give that to the Lord. It was not acceptable to God. So they had to examine it without blemish. Without spot, that means it couldn't have any birth defects. You know, it couldn't have a club foot or maybe missing an eye or something. It was not considered worthy to be sacrificed to the Lord. This was why the lambs had to be inspected during these days to make sure yet it was an acceptable sacrifice to the Lord. God didn't want leftovers. He didn't want people's cast-offs. But the most significant thing about these lambs is that they had to be without spot or blemish. They had to pass inspection. Therefore, they were acceptable to be sacrificed to the Lord. And again, all these things point to Jesus. And Jesus would be the ultimate Passover lamb. He would be the final sacrifice for our sins. He alone qualified to be that final sacrifice that God would receive. In fact, it was John the Baptist who proclaimed John chapter 1, verse 29. The next day, John, speaking of John the Baptist, saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And this theme of the Lamb of God as a covering for sin and as ultimately the removal of all of our sins in Christ is seen throughout the Bible. I mean, after Adam and Eve sinned against God, we're told that they tried to cover their own nakedness with fig leaves, and that was no good. It wasn't acceptable, their own efforts to cover themselves. So it says God, you know, killed an animal, probably the very first animal to ever die, because before Adam and Eve sinned, there was no death, because sin brings death. That's one of the reasons I believe in a young earth, because there was no death. It wasn't billions of years of dinosaurs eating everything up. No death until Adam and Eve sinned. And so then God kills the very first animal. I believe it was a lamb. And he covers them, it says, with skins. When Abraham was about to sacrifice his only son, Isaac, we know the angel of the Lord stopped him. But even before they go up on the mountain, we're told in Genesis 22, verse 8, and Abraham said to Isaac, "My son, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering." And so the two of them went together. And throughout history, the Jews have sacrificed millions upon millions of lambs in obedience to God. But it all pointed to, it all culminated with the sacrifice of Jesus upon the cross, where he would shed his perfect, spotless blood is the only acceptable payment for the sins of the world. Throughout the New Testament, we see Jesus depicted as the Lamb of God. In fact, as you remember, as we went through the book of Revelation, 28 times Jesus is called the Lamb. He is the final Lamb of God. So, as we'll see, this first Passover, this is a big deal, a really big deal. So again, from Nisan 10th through the 14th, these lambs were inspected. They'd be sacrificed on the 14th. So check this out. When Jesus comes, you know, riding on the little donkey, what we call the triumphal entry, he's on that little donkey coming into Jerusalem. What was the date? Nisan 10, the 10th of Nisan. That's when the lambs were inspected. I encourage you just read through Matthew 22. This is when the scribes and the religious leaders are examining Jesus. You know, making sure, testing him, you know, wanting, you know, he was spotless, he was blameless, but they questioned him on all kinds of things. Should we pay taxes to Caesar? You know, what about marriage? If somebody marries this gal, marries these seven brothers, and they all die, what about the resurrection? What's the greatest commandment in all, they said? Well, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Love your neighbors yourself. And so, be that as it may, they found no fault in him. Even when Jesus was before Pontius Pilate, he says, he's innocent. The thief on the cross says, this guy's done nothing wrong. They all knew this, the ultimate Lamb of God, was perfect in every way. And on the day of Passover, on the 14th of Nisan, Jesus was crucified on the cross, the Lamb of God. He breathed his last, and that was at 3 p.m. Because it tells us he was on the cross from 9 in the morning till 3. Those 6 hours, he paid the price in full. But not only would Jesus be qualified as a final perfect sacrifice for our sins, he alone would pay the price for our sins, his perfect spotless blood. That's why we have verses like 1 Peter 1. Verses 18 and 19, knowing that you are not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers. In other words, you couldn't work your way to heaven, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. So Let's continue on. Notice again in verse 3, real quick. It says, on the 10th of this month, every man shall take for himself a lamb according to the house of his father. In verse 4, and if the household is too small for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of persons. Come to verse 7, this will pick up. And they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses. So three times he mentions houses here, where they eat it. Verse 8, then they shall eat the flesh on that night, roasted in fire with unleavened bread, with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Do not eat it raw, nor boiled at all with water, but roasted in fire. Its head with its legs and its entrails. Yum. You shall let none of it remain until morning, and what remains of it until morning you shall burn with fire. And thus you shall eat it, with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. So you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. And so notice God is emphasizing here, as he institutes Passover, this was to be eaten where? In the house. This is not like for a big public setting, but everyone would be eating this meal within their homes. Again, you've got at least 2 million Jews at this time living in Egypt, because we'll see they had 600,000 plus just the young fighting men. Well, they all had wives, so there's 1.2 million. They all had at least one child, there's 1.8. Most Jews would not have just one child. They would have three, four, five kids. That's why I believe it's closer to 3 million people that would leave Egypt during this time. But be that as it may, you've got all these people, at least 2 million Jews will be participating in the Feast of Passover at the same time, all in their homes. I see this as another example in the Bible that the foundation God established for a people or a nation to succeed is found in the home. In other words, if the family is healthy, then the nation will be healthy and strong and free. And a healthy family can only be built on the truth of God's word. It can only be built on what God's word says about the family. Family is designed by God. Marriage is designed by God. And this is why Satan is at war against God's foundation and his definition of marriage and family. This is why there's so much confusion today about people's identity, people's sexuality, people's gender. There shouldn't be any confusion about these things. Satan is attacking these biblical truths because he knows this is how you weaken and eventually destroy a culture. So here we see that Passover was celebrated in the home. Now, another important thing we see here is that everyone was to partake in eating the lamb in these homes. It wasn't just for a select few people in the home, but each person would feed upon the lamb that was sacrificed and roasted. And so this is a great picture of our salvation. Every one of us must believe in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. Everyone must personally ask Christ, be my Lord and Savior. Come into my life and save me. In other words, it's not enough to have a lot of right information about Jesus. It's not enough just to have a bunch of facts about the gospel of Christ, but it's a personal matter. You have to personally believe in Christ and receive him as your Lord and Savior if you want to be saved. Your parents may be Christians or were Christians. That doesn't mean you are. Your grandparents may have been Christian. That doesn't mean you are. It's a personal matter. John chapter 1, verse 12, very clear. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name. Once again, nobody is saved just because they grew up in a church. Nobody is saved because of their parents or grandparents. You must eat of the lamb personally. You must eat of the lamb yourself. Even Jesus tells us this in John chapter 6, verse 51. Jesus says, I am the living bread, which came down from heaven, referring to the manna that we'll talk about later in Exodus. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give him is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world. I mean, that's what communion is all about. We're partaking, feasting upon the reality of who Christ is. Nobody else can eat or believe or receive Jesus for you. That's a decision only you can make for yourself. Just remember this. Jesus wants you to believe in him. He wants you to receive him. He loves you, and God demonstrated his own love for you. Now, while you're still dead in your sins, he died for you. He wants you to come into a relationship with him. Jesus is the ultimate Passover lamb. Jesus was sacrificed for your sins. He died in your place. Now he says, come to me, dine with me, feast with me. Isn't this what we read in Revelation 3:20? You know, this is Jesus speaking to the church of Laodicea in the last days, which is today, the last days. But this is for individuals as well, not just people in a church, but for individuals. He says this, put it up there. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone, that means anybody in any church that's just going through the motions. I know there's people here, you're going through the motions. You think, hey, I go to church, I read my Bible once in a while, so I'm good. Are you? I don't know. God knows your heart. I hope you're right with God. But he says, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and notice and dine with him and he with me. Feast is what it means. I will dine. I will feast with you. He wants to partake in that fellowship with you. Another important thing to take note of here is that the father in the home, the head of the household, he was responsible for taking this, which is now a pet lamb, and killing it, slitting its throat, pouring out the blood, and then they would barbecue it. I'm sure it smelled great, but can you imagine just the emotion of that? I mean, it's playing with your mind. This innocent lamb is dying because I'm a guilty sinner before God. I've disobeyed God. That blood was poured out because I've rejected God's word, or I've done these things against my neighbor. He's dying in my place. His lamb is dying for me. And so the father is responsible to take that innocent lamb and you know, kill it. And then we'll see, he'll put the blood on the lintel and the doorpost. And so it's a substitutionary death, a transfer of your family's sin onto this unblemished, spotless lamb, which was then again killed for your sins, dying in your place. God was not only ministering to each family member's minds, but I'm sure it had a huge impact on their hearts. I mean, just think of the kids, you know, seeing, oh, little Fluffy. I mean, that'd be brutal. You know, we have a dog, you know, Lando. We've had him, 4 months now. I mean, he's precious. I would hate to see something happen to him. I mean, we've fallen in love with him. Not so much this morning. I let him out of his kennel, you know, fed him. And for whatever reason, he runs upstairs and he looks at Elizabeth, cocks his leg, and starts peeing on the rug. I said, what? What are you doing? And she went a little ballistic. So then you're like, I could see roasting him right now. But most of the time, it's like, no, he's so sweet, he's so cute. But if you had to do that with your pet, I mean, think of the Jews having to do this with their little lambs that they've been raising from babies. So the substitutionary death of Jesus upon the cross should have been, and I'm sure it had a greater impact upon their hearts and minds, and it should have a greater impact when we think of Jesus dying as a substitute for our sins. He not only has covered us with his blood, he has cleansed us from every sin we have ever committed and will ever commit. The Bible says he has washed our sins away as far as the east is from the west, and he remembers them no more. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, for he, God, made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So Jesus on the cross, the Lamb of God, the Father dumped all of our guilt, our sin, our shame upon his son Jesus. In exchange, we received his very own righteousness and forgiveness, a future home in glory. In other words, any way you slice it, God didn't get the best end of this deal. We certainly did. And we'll see later in this chapter, the key to all of this was the blood of the Lamb. In other words, when the death angel would pass over the homes, striking the firstborn in every house, if he saw the blood, he passed over. That's what Passover comes from. In the same way, you and I are spared spiritual death only because we are cleansed, we are covered by the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ. Also notice here in verse 8, that they were to eat the lamb, which was roasted in fire. That's a picture of God's judgment, roasting this in fire. It's a picture that God poured out his judgment and wrath upon Jesus. And even as it says here in verse 10, that if there was any meat left over in the morning, it was to be burned with fire. So Jesus not only paid the price in full for our sins, he took all the wrath and judgment that we deserve upon himself for our sins. Remember when he's hanging on the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? I believe that was the moment when the Father was pouring out his wrath upon his innocent son, the wrath that we deserve. And this is why the Bible says that we're not destined for wrath, but to obtain salvation through Jesus. I don't believe we're going through the great tribulation. That's when God's wrath will be poured out. Jesus took the wrath we deserve already upon himself. Now, again in verse 8, God instructed them to eat unleavened bread. We've talked about this before. Leaven, yeast, it represents sin. You'd put a little leaven in the bread dough. It'd permeate all the bread, and then it causes it to swell up. Picture of sin, pride, a little sin in our life. If we don't repent, we don't get rid of it, it'll just start eating away at your life. It'll start slowly spreading throughout your life. It'll make you puffed up. It'll permeate our lives and cause all kinds of problems. And so Jesus is pictured as unleavened bread, and that's because he was and is sinless. We also see they were to eat bitter herbs here. Why? Because that would remind them of all the bitterness that they experienced as slaves there in Egypt. It would leave a bad taste in your mouth. For us, there should be a bad taste in our mouth about our BC days. You know, Satan is so good at trying to glamorize, reinterpret our past sinful lifestyles. He'll say, wasn't your past easier? No, it wasn't. Wasn't your past more fun when you lived in the world? No, it wasn't. But so often people think, yeah, it was kind of fun and free back then. No, you were in bondage. You were separated from God. There was no joy. It was just one thing after another that was taking you down a path of destruction. Finally, in verse 11, the Jews, when I said finally, it doesn't mean I'm wrapping it up, by the way. I like what the Apostle Paul does. Halfway through his letters, he'll say, and finally, halfway through his letter. No, I'm almost done. But in verse 11, the Jews were told to eat this meal in haste. In other words, wolf it down. You're going to be getting out of here. You're going to be on the run here shortly. And once God gave them the signal, they were to flee their old life. They were to leave it behind. They were to run toward the new life that God had prepared for them. And that's where we should be right now. Leave the old behind. We're pressing forward, moving forward with Jesus. Look at verse 12. It says, for I will pass through the land of Egypt on that night and will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. Now the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. Again, that's where Passover comes from. Death angel passed over the houses when he saw the blood. The blood was the key. Now think about this. They could have done everything God told them to do. Take the lamb, kill it, eat it, you know, eat unleavened bread. you know, we'll get the gold and silver from our neighbors. But if they didn't apply the blood, they would all be dead. There was death, you know, and that's the same true for us. You know, a lot of people think, well, you know, I'm really into religion. I like religion. Oh, I like to read the Bible. I like to pray once in a while. Yeah, I'll go to church. You know, religion is great. If you don't apply the blood of Jesus to your life, guess what? You're dead. You can't just go through the rituals of church and think, oh, I'm good with God. No, you have to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You have to apply the blood. Otherwise, all these other things you do, they're meaningless. They won't give you any life. The Bible is clear. Hebrews 9:22 says, according to the law, almost all things are purified with blood. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission or there's no forgiveness of sin. You know, too many people think, well, I love all these things about Christianity, but when you start talking about the blood, that's nasty. That's kind of messy. That's kind of narrow-minded that you have to believe in the blood. Well, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. That's pretty narrow. The only way you can be saved is through Jesus. That's really narrow. His blood is the only acceptable payment for your sins. I would say that's really narrow. And then in Hebrews 10:4, we're told, for it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats could take away sins, or any other animal. I mean, they sacrificed all kinds of animals in Israel. But none of it could take away your sins. It was a temporary covering for sins. This is why Jesus had to come. Jesus was our substitute. He died his death for us. He suffered God's wrath for our sins. And the plague of sin is no longer upon our lives, and it cannot destroy us. And it's only because we've applied the blood of Jesus, you might say, to the doors of our heart. Gotta apply the blood to the door of our heart. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone will open up the door, I'll come into him, I'll dine with him, and he with me. Now, it's interesting because here we see God will initiate another feast. You have Passover, and then immediately tied into it is another feast called the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Passover one day, then the next 7 days, the Feast of Unleavened Bread. We'll see in a moment, there's actually a third feast that was added in that same time frame, and they all point to Jesus. Look at verse 14. So this day shall be to you a memorial, and you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. You shall keep it as a feast by an everlasting ordinance. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread. On the first day you shall remove leaven from your houses. For whoever eats leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that person shall be cut off from Israel. I think this was important. To be cut off from Israel means you would be put to death. On the first day, verse 16, there shall be a holy convocation. On the seventh day, there shall be a holy convocation for you. No manner of work shall be done on them, but that which everyone must eat, that only may be prepared by you. So you shall observe the Feast of Unleavened Bread, for on this same day I will have brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Again, God sees the end from the beginning. You think the Israelites are looking at themselves like, yeah, we're a mighty army, 600,000 young men. They've never held a weapon in their life. They've never battled. They've been slaves. They haven't had anything. But yet God, who began a good work in them, will complete it. God, who began a good work in you, will complete it. You look in the mirror, oh man, I got a long way to go, Lord. He who began that good work, he will complete it. So don't get too discouraged when you look in the mirror or you look in your own heart. Armies, therefore you shall observe this day throughout your generations as an everlasting ordinance. Now, as they get into the wilderness and they're wandering, they'll be there out there for 40 years because of their disobedience. But in Leviticus chapter 23, verses 9 through 11, God implements a third feast that goes along with Passover, unleavened bread, and 3 days after Passover is what feast? The Feast of first fruits. Leviticus 23, verse 9 through 11. It would be an offering when they get into, because looking forward, when they get into the promised land, their first fruits, the very first things that start to grow during harvest time, they would offer that to the Lord, thanking him for what he's going to do in the future with their harvest. Again, all these feasts point to Jesus. Jesus dies on the cross on Passover, 3 p.m. Into your hands I commit my spirit. Passover, the blameless, blemishless, without spot or blemish, unleavened Jesus placed in the tomb. On the third day, and by the way, the Feast of First Fruits always took place on the first Sunday after Passover. So what's the first Sunday after Passover? What we call Resurrection Sunday, Easter. That's the first Feast of First Fruits. So Jesus raised from the dead. All these things point us to the Lord. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 20. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep, those who have died. Because Jesus, he conquered the grave eternally with a resurrection body. That's our sign. That's all we need to know, that he is going to give us a resurrection body in the near future. Verse 18, real quickly. In the first month, on the 14th day of the month at evening, you shall eat unleavened bread until the 21st day of the month at evening. For 7 days, no leaven shall be found in your house, since whoever eats what is leavened, that same person shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he is a stranger or a native of the land. You shall eat nothing leavened in all your dwellings. You shall eat unleavened bread. Now again, leaven or yeast is a picture of sin, and it reminded the Jews that they didn't have time to bake their bread with leaven, because you put the leaven in, it'd take a few hours at least to permeate the dough. God is saying, no, you're not going to put leaven in, because you're going to make this, you're going to bake it, and you're going to eat it in haste, because this is going to be, you're going to be eating and running. You're going to be in and out burgers. Oh, that was good. I had a few of those. Sorry. So this night, there's no time for leaven. It's time to get out of here quickly. Verse 21. Then Moses called for all the elders of Israel and said to them, pick out and take lambs for yourselves according to your families and kill the Passover lamb. And you shall take a bunch of hyssop, dip it in the blood and that is in the basin, strike the lintel and the two doorposts, so the header above and the two doorposts on the side, with the blood that is in the basin. And none of you shall go out of the door of his house until morning, for the Lord will pass through to strike the Egyptians. And when he sees the blood on the lintel and the two doorposts, the Lord will pass over the door and not allow the destroyer to come into your houses to strike you. And you shall observe this thing as an ordinance for you and your sons forever. How do we do this forever? Well, Jesus is the Passover lamb. He fulfilled this forever. Then it says, it shall come to pass when you come to the land which the Lord will give you, just as he promised, that you shall keep this service. And it shall be when your children say to you, what do you mean by this service, this Passover celebration? That you shall say, it is the Passover sacrifice of the Lord who passed over the houses of the children of Israel in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians and delivered our households. So the people bowed their heads and worshipped. Then the children of Israel went away and did so just as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron. So they did. And so this was to be observed and practiced in the Jewish homes forever. It's truly a special time. It still is a very special time for the Jewish people. And over the years, they've added a few elements to Passover. And remember when Rabbi Jack Zimmerman was here, when was that, March? February? March? Go online, watch the Seder that he did. It was awesome. I mean, he went into all these great details about the Passover. One of the things that's been added over the years is salt water. They'd have salt water there when you do the Seder because it reminds you, the Jews, of the tears that were shed. They would have a boiled egg, new life coming from the egg. But it seems Jesus observed, you know, this Passover, very detailed. And a few of the highlights are simply these. They have 4 cups of wine for blessing. But it was between the first and second cups, they had, you know, matzos bread, flat bread, unleavened bread. They have 3 sheets of that matzos. And it was in a linen napkin. They bring out those 3, and you would have the middle one taken out, broken in half. It was wrapped up in linen and hidden away. And so for the Jewish children, it became a game. Let's go find the unleavened bread that's been broken and hidden away in linen. And when they bring it back, sometimes they'd give them, you know, a reward, a prize or something. It really speaks again of Jesus. The 3 matzos. You got the Father, the middle, Jesus, the Holy Spirit. Jesus broken in half on the cross, broken for our sins, wrapped in linen after Joseph of Arimathea. And Nick at night, they take him from the cross, wrap him in linen, put him in the tomb. And when the children would find that hidden broken piece of matzos, they'd celebrate. They're all excited and happy. Well, when Jesus rose from the tomb, just imagine the joy, the excitement, you know, when the disciples see our risen Lord and Savior. How amazing. We'll stop here. There's so much more we could talk about with the Seder and Passover. Again, I recommend looking up the Seder that we did here with Rabbi Jack. It was awesome. But before we close in prayer, let me just say this. Make sure that the blood of Jesus is applied to your life. Not only is Jesus the Passover lamb, but he's also the door that we must go through for salvation. Picture this, John chapter 10, verse 9. Jesus says, "I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture." He's the door. Through his blood, just picture the blood on that door. Anytime we go in and out, we're covered by the blood of Jesus. We know that his blood has washed us clean of all sin. That should always remind us, we are clean, we are forgiven, we are redeemed, and it's all because of the finished work of Christ, the ultimate Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world.